So thank you all for having me. As mentioned, my name is Tim Hade. I work at a company called Scale Microgrid Solutions. And one of the things that we do there is we build sustainable energy systems for indoor agriculture facilities. And while the customers we work with produce a wide variety of crops, one is more prominent than the others. And so today I'm gonna tell you the story of how we got involved in selling some of the most sophisticated on-site energy systems on the planet to marijuana farmers. In order to do that, I gotta take you back a few years to when I was in business school. And truthfully, I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life, other than I was really interested in the energy industry. And one day, kind of out of the blue, my childhood best friend, a guy by the name of Ryan Goodman, called me to tell me that he was leaving his like pretty ritzy corporate job to go back and take over his family business, which was a small standby generator company based in New Jersey. And the idea was he was going to go back and turn it into a sustainable energy company. And so I was pretty intrigued, and I started asking a bunch of questions. And what came out of the conversation over the next hour was a lot, but two things really stuck with me. The first thing Ryan told me is he was really concerned about climate change, as I was. But he phrased it in a way that really resonated with me. And what he said was, I think this is going to be the issue that defines our generation in the history books. And at some point in time, I'm going to have to sit down with my kids and my grandkids and tell them what I did about it. And I want to be able to tell a good story. And then the second thing he said was, in his view, selling climate solutions was a tremendous economic opportunity, and he thought he was going to get rich in the process. And I didn't really have anything better to do, so a few months later I moved back to New Jersey, and that's where we begin our journey. And what happens over the next few years, I don't really have time to go into. But I think people have mentioned it today, right? There's a really steep learning curve if you're gonna go into the energy industry. And so what happens to us over the next few years can loosely be described as a combination of successes and failures. But ultimately, we built a pretty successful cogeneration company that got acquired. It's still producing really high quality CHP systems today. And while we were on this whole journey, Ryan, his father Howard, and I had kind of stumbled on what you could loosely say is a more aggressive thesis, and it's this, is kind of a good way to summarize it. And I realize this sounds like a pretty extreme statement, so I just want to spend a minute on this, right? And so the Paris Agreement tells us that if we want to solve the climate change problem, we have to do three things. The first thing is mitigation, which is when we talk about climate change as a society, what we talk about the most. We have to reduce the amount of greenhouse gas emissions that exist, right? And then potentially suck some out of the atmosphere as well. But the second thing the Paris Agreement says is we have to adapt. Because no matter what we do, it's going to be bad. And so we need more resilient infrastructure that's better equipped to deal with changing weather patterns, more extreme weather events, things of that nature. And then the third thing the Paris Agreement says is that we have to figure out how to pay for the first two things. And I just want to take a minute and talk about that adaption point because we don't talk about it enough. And so basically, since electricity has become a commercial product, it's been produced the same way, which is we have these big central power plants, and they're connected to end-use customers via this vast array of wires that we call the transmission and distribution infrastructure. And it turns out that in the United States today, roughly 98% of all power outages are caused by failure in the transmission and distribution infrastructure. And so if you have to build a system that's more resilient, the wires are a problem. And somebody has to deal with those. So we started building these. Essentially what these are microgrids. Microgrids is a big word that encompasses a lot of things. But the way we build microgrids, we build them all behind the meter for customers. And these are essentially power plants that sit behind the meter. They use a combination of natural gas, solar, and battery storage, and they work in what's called grid parallel mode during normal operating conditions. So we work with the existing electric grid, but in the event of a grid disruption, the entire system is islandable. So one way to think about it is it's the world's fanciest standby generator. And there's a lot of reason to be optimistic about this type of technology. So I love analyst projections, because basically every analyst projection from people that really look at this industry says, we're nearing this inflection point and there's gonna be exponential growth. And beyond just loving analyst projections, it also kind of makes sense, right? And You know, we don't have to go into a lot of this because I think, you know, Andy did a really nice job talking about this earlier. But the value proposition of microgrids is there. And so there's a lot of reason for optimism, but the problem I have on a day-to-day basis is it's not happening. That inflection point hasn't happened yet. And, you know, while you can't look at data over this period and say, well, that's evidence that this trend isn't going to occur, I can tell you that when you have payroll to make and you've started a company, waiting years is not the most fun thing in the world. And so I'm very anxious for that inflection point to happen. And so that's the big question facing the microgrid industry today, which is if you have this great value proposition, why aren't there more microgrids? And that's a very long discussion, but one of the insights we have based off of our experience is pretty simple, which is, to paraphrase, people don't care, right? And so if you look at, you know, basically I can build a microgrid for any commercial industrial facility in the United States that has a base load above, call it 200 kilowatts, right? And if you take that as the sample size of potential customers, the overwhelming majority of people that run those facilities do not care about energy. And so, you know, over the course of the last few years, I've had conversations with hundreds of executives, and this is generally what they tell me. They say, Timmy, I really appreciate your presentation. Looks like you put a lot of hard work into it. However, I don't care. And let me tell you why I don't care. It's because energy costs are not a problem for me, right? I run a hospital. Energy costs are maybe 1% of my total operating budget, and the nurses union is the next meeting. So if you don't mind, get out of my office so I can prepare for that, right? But that's something we have to realize, right, is that we're trying to make this transition happen. And for most people outside of this industry, the status quo is not a problem, right? Energy is cheap. Energy is fairly reliable. It's not resilient, but because you don't lose power that much, no one cares. And, you know, it's hard to understand the sustainability aspect, because when you guys go out and talk to people, you'll see in today's climate, right, everyone has a good answer for sustainability, which is basically like it's a core competency of our organization. Every decision that we make, sustainability is a factor. But let's just say, like, that doesn't always play out in practice, right? And so there aren't a lot of companies out there today that are making economically or like NPV negative decisions for sustainability reasons. And so this is essentially what our job becomes, right? We have this really cool technology that we want to bring to market. And we know that the value proposition fits for, you know, this huge chunk of commercial and industrial facilities in the United States. But we have to find the people who care enough to like invest the time to do a complicated energy project, and that's really hard. And it's frustrating, and it sucks from my perspective, but it's also not a good business model, right? Because it's not scalable and it's not replicable. And I can't go to investors and say my plan is to dig through this haystack, and like some years I might find three needles and some years I might find one needle, and people don't like putting money into that. And so the challenge for microgrid companies in today's environment is how do you develop a scalable, replicable business model? And this brings us to marijuana. And so before I go into this, I'm just a few things you guys might want to know about the marijuana industry overall outside of energy. The first is it's the fastest growing industry in the United States. It's currently legal for recreational use in 8 states. And they're on track to do about $15 billion in retail sales in the United States this year, which makes the marijuana industry roughly 1.5 times the size of the NFL. The second thing you need to know about the marijuana industry is that in states where it's legal, almost all marijuana production occurs indoors. To understand that production process, all you need to know is they buy a building, and then they recreate the sun inside, and then they never turn it off. And so needless to say, marijuana production is an extremely energy intensive process. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of good data out there. So one of the big challenges we have is how do you actually know how much energy the cannabis industry is using? And so I'll just take a minute. One of our employees is a kid named Duncan Campbell, and he kind of took this initiative took the bull by the horn, so to speak, and he organized the most comprehensive energy study of the marijuana industry that's been done today. Because remember, because of the legal status of marijuana in the country, it's something that really any research university that gets federal funding won't touch, and the national labs won't touch, because it's an illegal federal product, so there's not a lot of good data out there. And so that report's available for free, and you can go there and you can learn a lot more about the energy consumption of marijuana production facilities than you could a few months ago. But I think like one way to put it in perspective is on this chart here. So we had a great panel earlier that talked about how electric vehicles were going to be responsible for all this load growth. And it turns out that legalizing marijuana results in twice as much load growth as electric vehicles to date. And so we saw this and we said, okay, well, this is a big problem to solve. And we got a lot of feedback that we were kind of crazy. But here's what ultimately pushed us over the tipping point. I can sell microgrids to marijuana farmers, right? And my sales pitch goes something like this. So I can reduce your operating costs by something like 7%, because energy costs are actually 30 to 40% of your total operating costs. And I can reduce your energy costs by 25%. And all of a sudden, you are the low price supplier in what's ultimately a price sensitive market. So you're going to gain a bunch of market share, and you're going to become one of the preeminent marijuana producers in your state. So that's good on the economic side of things. On the resiliency side of things, if you don't have a standby generator and you're a marijuana farmer, you're an idiot. Because it turns out that cannabis is a little bit hard to insure. And so if you have a power outage, right, and you have the sun recreated inside, and the sun turns off, in a matter of hours, you start to see the crop get affected. And if you go really anywhere in the 24-hour range, longer duration outage, you lose the entire crop. And since we started this company 3 years ago, we've had multiple companies that we've been working with go out of business in the process because they had a power outage, they lost their entire crop, they didn't have insurance, and they didn't have the cash in the bank to cover that. And so from a resiliency perspective, you can either have a diesel generator or you can have this, but you need something, right? And so I can sell the resiliency piece. And then on the sustainability piece, this is where I have to give a lot of credit to the cannabis industry, right? Because most of the entrepreneurs we're working with understand that their business is questioned by society, right? And so while most of these people, when they got into the space, didn't understand the environmental or energy implications of what they were doing, once they found out about the problem, they're all about trying to be part of the solution because they genuinely want to be good members of the community. And so we've had a lot more success in the cannabis industry as opposed to other industries we work in selling the sustainability benefits of microgrids. Part of that is also there tends to be an overlap between people who care about climate change and but for whatever reason, that exists, right? And so I guess this is what I'll leave you with, and then I'm happy to answer questions. When I was in business school, I thought about the energy industry way too academically, right? Which is, there's all these problems out there. There's more problems than anyone can handle. So if I get involved and I like come up with some solutions, the money will make itself. And it's not true, right? It turns out that the hardest thing that we've had to do is not engineer cool solutions or create products or figure out the engineering or the design. The hardest thing we've had to do is sell these things. And we have to sell them because we have to make money. And ultimately, we want to make a company that can really have an impact on a global scale with respect to climate change. And in order to do that, you have to be able to go to investors and be like, here's all the money we made you. And you can't do that if you don't have customers. And so we went in the marijuana industry because we have customers, and it's as simple as that. And I'm pretty optimistic about the future in that space and some of the other stuff we're doing. But I'm done with time, so I'll take questions. Thank you.
Thank you. That was very interesting. One of the often less talked about projected impacts of climate change is on agriculture. And in addition to energy security, that has implications for things like food security. A projected solution for resiliency in that space is indoor agriculture, much like what you're talking about. And as much as I'm sure everyone loves the ability to grow marijuana, I think the ability to grow food will also be very important in the coming decades. And I was wondering if you have had any conversations or even just idle thoughts about the implications of your technology for that aspect of climate resiliency.
Absolutely. So I said, as I started out saying, like, our customers grow a wide variety of crops. So we're actually working with a bunch of the bigger vertical farm companies right now on solutions. And we actually, in concert with Andy's company and the Schneider Electric guys, I think next week we're going to announce a big deal we just did with one of the bigger startups in the indoor agriculture space. I probably wasn't supposed to say that, but now you know. But it's a real problem, right? And so problematically, right, if you just look at indoor agriculture as a niche, 95% of that industry is marijuana, right? But that 5% that's not is really interesting. And the value proposition basically boils down to this. 85% of the arable land on Earth is already used. The population is growing, and we have this climate change monster coming towards us that's probably going to reduce our ability to produce food outside. So we need to learn how to grow it indoors. And so we're working with a lot of companies that are on the cutting edge of that right now. And there's a lot of benefits to that type of technology, right? 95% less water is used in the production process. They produce crops that, well, they don't have like the organic label. We're working with a company right now where you get a package of lettuce, and when you open the package, you're the first human to touch the lettuce. No pesticides, no herbicides, no nothing. And so it's a really exciting space, but it's very much in its infancy, right? And so, quite frankly, like, we couldn't build a business on the back of vertical farming. We can build a business on the back of marijuana. And so that's why, you know, marijuana is just a much bigger part of our portfolio right now. But we are doing a lot of cool stuff with vertical agriculture companies, and it's a very good question.
Okay, thanks, Tim, so much. Can everybody give Tim a round of applause?
Cool.